All right, guys, so what we're going to do here is I'm going to go over a little bit of like the anatomy. I'm going to go over a little bit of like what we're looking for when it comes to mobility versus flexibility. I want you guys, as we do this, to move your bodies a little bit. So you have one of three variations that you can choose. Sitting on your knees and doing a kneeling hip hinge until you can't anymore. Don't do it yet because you're going to be doing it for a while. Or if you want to progress from this kneeling hinge, notice that I'm sitting my hips back, I'm bringing my hips forward, I'm squeezing. You can also do a shin box. A shin box is a 45-45, driving through the knees and coming up into a seat kneeling position and then sitting back down. This is a really great way to warm up the hips. You're going to go to one side and then you'll turn around and you'll do the other side. If you're more on the advanced side and you'd like a little bit more advanced, you can go from your shin box and then you can step forward into a lunge. And then you back to a shin box. And you go up to a shin box and do a lunge. So start small, especially if you're someone that has a little bit of issues. We're going to go either the first variation, the shin box, or the other while I explain. I want you to just go until you can't go anymore and then rest. And then keep going. And then if you do one side, make sure you get the other side. So let's talk about the anatomy of the hip. The anatomy of the hip, you have a ball and socket joint. It's the biggest joint in the body. You have your femur bone, the big long femur bone, and it sits in that ball and socket joint. Once that hip, once you have that ball and socket joint, there are different depths of your hip. So some people have shallow hip sockets and a lot more range of motion. Some people have deep hip sockets, usually people that are a little bit taller, and then they have a little bit harder time getting different ranges of motion. So hips, everybody's body in here is different. And so everyone, when we do our squats, our deep squats, we're gonna have a slightly different way to do it that fits us best, right? On that ball and socket joint, you then have a bunch of tissue along the capsule. Tendons connect bones to bones. Tendons connect muscle to bones. And then you have the ligaments that connect bone to bone. The most famous ligament that everyone thinks is a tendon is your patella tendon. This is actually a ligament because it attaches bone to bone. So in your hip joint, you have a bunch of ligaments that attach your hip bone to your leg bone. And that capsule gets tight a lot. So if you ever feel pinching in your hips, does anyone feel any pinching in their hips right now? No pinching? Great. We just need to create a little bit of space sometimes in that hip socket joint. I'll send a video where you take a band and you get that band around your inner thigh and then you pull that leg bone out and you create space. It almost all the time works getting that pinching hip to alleviate a little bit. From there, we have different ability levels when it comes to how we connect to our muscles. So everyone knows that your brain controls everything you do, right? Your brain sends an electrical signal to the muscle to either contract or to let go. Contract or let go. Muscles don't lengthen, they let go. Right? Your brain sends an electrical signal for that muscle to contract and get closer to each other. That's how muscles work. So when we do mobility, we're thinking we want to have more engagement from the brain to the muscles. So if I want to do a static stretch is where I get into a stretch and I relax into it. So if you've taken yin yoga classes with me, that is static stretching. Great for creating length. But what it's not great for is controlling that muscle in a full range of motion. So mobility is your ability to get into a deep stretch and then to activate that muscle. So I'm going to talk to you guys about activating and creating tension with the muscle today. So if I was to be in this position, rather than just relaxing into it, what I would do is I would drive my heels down into the floor and I would activate all of the muscles of the back of my leg. And I would do that like a dimmer switch. So think about it, your house, if you have a dimmer switch, you have a light that gets brighter and brighter and brighter. We want to do that with our intention, sending that electrical signal heavier, heavier, and heavier. Your body will only use as much muscle as it takes to do the minimal amount to work. So for me to pick up this phone, I could pick up 1,000 of these phones at one time and I could lift it up, right? But my body doesn't just throw this phone through the roof because I know how much I need to use. So I am only using the minimal amount of muscle motor unit recruitment to lift that phone. What I want you guys to do is I want you to make that brain maximize the amount of muscle motor units that you recruit. Does that make sense? So if I'm here, I'm gonna slowly start to drive my heels into the ground harder, harder, and harder until I can't go any harder. And then from there, I'll have you do some extra movements and we'll start to earn the ability to get into the lengthened range of motion and strengthen those muscles in that longest range of motion. That's mobility, the difference between flexibility. Cool? Anybody have questions on that? It's kind of like an anatomy lesson there. So we talked about it. If your foot is dysfunctional, if I have, just like Aaron said, if her foot pronates, what's that going to do to my knees and my hips? All the way up the chain, now I'm out of alignment. So a lot of times we wear these shoes that have these big soles, these cushions on, which are great for preventing injuries when running, but they're really, really bad for strengthening the muscles of your feet. So when you say orthotics is like wearing a back brace. So you're giving yourself a Band-Aid to help fix it and help keep you pain-free. But what happens when you remove a Band-Aid? Now it's your body doing the work, and the more you wear that Band-Aid, the weaker your muscles get, the harder it gets. So it's the same thing with our feet. To get out of pain, maybe we wear an orthotic, but then we spend more time barefoot so that we can start to strengthen the muscles under our feet so that we can create an arch on our, by ourselves, and we can make sure that that knee stays in alignment. Same thing with the hips. A lot of times when we sit, our glutes are weak, and we have a hard time connecting to our glutes. Our adductors, our inside muscles, they get tight. And so what that does is it pulls our knees into this position. Once we get into this position, now that track of our knees, it's no longer on that smooth groove. It's grinding on a thing that it shouldn't. And that's why we feel pain in our knees when we squat. This is definitely over-exaggerated, but even just a centimeter off can add up over time, especially if you're putting a bunch of weight on your body or in your arms. So what we want to do is we want to strengthen the outer hips. We want to find control of our glutes. We want to lengthen the inner thighs. And we want to make sure that we have a strong foundation. So today we'll be talking about all of that stuff when we go through our flow. So if you feel things into your lower back and up into your neck, it can stem all the way down from the ground. Everything up the chain is then dysfunctional and not on track and not in alignment. So it's definitely a long, long process to try to fix it, but it's doable. As long as you put in the work. Let me see if my battery's going low. Yeah. Okay, so any questions on that?
No.
Okay, so what we're gonna do is we are now going to talk about, we're gonna do a little test. How's everyone's hips feel after doing all those movements?
Good.
Good, good. Any pain on anyone? I wanna know, yeah, me.
I just have a question because since my accident, this doesn't bend anyone. That's so, how do you, like they're all doing this up and down thing.
Yeah.
I just won't do it.
So when you get injured, your body goes into a protection phase. There's trauma, and your body wants to keep you alive. That's like the number one thing your body wants to do. So if I step off a curb when I'm 20 and I sprain my ankle, and it's a pretty bad sprain, and I have to wear a boot, then my foot heals. Well, now I have a little bit of what they call scar tissue. You have tissue that your body goes to rebuild that area stronger and more stable so that it doesn't hurt again. It doesn't want to do that again. But what happens when I get more stability? I lose range of motion. I lose the ability to control it in that range of motion. And also my brain is psychologically, everywhere that I go, remembering that one off step. And so it's going to make sure that I'm protected. That's sometimes a good thing, but if over time, it's not a good thing because then you start to get into those positions where you're stiff. And now I can't move anymore. I've had shoulder stuff, I've had knee stuff, I've had hip stuff. So your goal is to create space in that capsule. The way I want to do that is I want to stretch the muscles of the front of the thigh so that I can get more range of motion. I want to put a towel behind my knee, and I want to get a little more space in that capsule. So I'll talk a little bit about that and help you get a little more range of motion after this. But that's how injuries work. So if anyone in here has had a bad injury, your body is in this trauma mode where it protects. So our goal is to lean into discomfort. Anytime you're recovering from injuries, anytime that you're getting into a range of motion that you haven't earned yet, it's gonna be uncomfortable, and it's gonna be a slightly painful. You have to figure out the difference between pain with purpose and sharp pain. Pain that's doing more damage than good. And mobility is a lot of pain with purpose. So,
Queen of scar tissue.
What I want you guys to do right now is I want you to do a before test. We're going to do a squat, 5 regular squats, and we're going to do 2 deep squats. So everybody go ahead and stand up real quick. I want you to remember what this feels like because we're going to do the exact same thing at the very end. So feet hip width apart, we're gonna do 5 regular squats where your hips go to 90 degrees, your knees go to 90 degrees. Remember how it feels, remember any stiffness, any places where your body's leaning forward, any pain. And then we're gonna go into 2 deep squats. Your feet stay in the same place, 2 deep squats. Notice if your heels come off the floor, notice if your chest falls forward, if your back rounds.
Yeah.
Once you finish your deep squat, go one more time. Notice any sticky parts. Notice if your toes are angled sideways or if your toes are forward. Remember that.
Yeah, I can't even get down.
Okay?
If I do it
Yeah, it takes a long time. Okay, team, so what we're going to do now is we're going to go through a flow. And I want you guys to follow me. We're going to start it off. Let me get some. Okay, so we'll start off with some leg swings. Forward and back leg swings. For us to be able to get our mobility, we need to be able to create some movement in the joint. When you move your joints, you bring synovial fluid into that joint, and it starts to lubricate it like a car engine. So putting oil in the engine, now the pistons can fire. Same thing when you start to move your muscles in your joints. That's why you always want to do a dynamic warm-up before you work out, and a static stretch only after. Switch legs forward and back. So our first thing to do here is to create some movement. This is why on all of our warm-ups, before we go in our back squats and all that, I have you doing those dynamic stretches to better create a injury resistant experience as well as a better performance experience. Let's take that first leg and go side to side. Try to lead with your heel. Try to point your toes straight forward. You're also stabilizing on one hip right now, so your grounded leg hip is working hard to keep you stable. Switch legs. Once we finish our dynamic movements, then we can go into our mobility holds, and we can start to work on getting into a long range of motion and firing that muscle, and then you want to finish static effort. Okay, from here, we're going to take it into thigh huggers. Knee up, and if you feel good, I want you to take your tippy toes, and I want you to lift your knee a little higher and come up onto your tippy toes. Yeah, balance, stability. Everything stems from the ground up. Think about pushing through the ball of your big toe. Frankenstein walks, go forward with the leg, opposite arm forward. Stretch dynamically the back of the leg. So hamstrings, notoriously on everybody, are super tight. When your hamstrings, the back of your legs are tight, it starts to pull on your glutes, which will tuck your tailbone under, which puts a lot of stress on that low back. So if we can get these hamstrings to loosen up, a lot of times the dysfunction at the hips starts to neutralize the pelvis and get a little bit of alleviation of pain. All right, up and over for a hip opener. Up and over and switch legs. Think about the leg bone in your hip. Think about that leg bone making the biggest range of motion while keeping your pelvis still. Nice. One more each side. And then from here, take it into a low side lunge. You're gonna take your feet super wide. You're gonna lean to the side. Now, keeping your butt low, shift your hips and weight all the way across. Your abductors, remember when your abductors are tight, they start to pull those knees inside, which accompanied with weak glutes, not a great combination for alignment. So being able to lengthen the inside of your thighs and the back of your thighs really will help us out here. All right, friends, we're gonna spend the rest of it down on the mat, so go ahead and find a seat. Feet as wide as your mat, and we're gonna take the knees to one side. Sit up tall and see if you can counter twist your upper body, and then switch. What you're feeling on that counter twist is what we call internal rotation. When this knee is internally rotated, you are probably the weakest. This is where most people struggle the most. Does anyone feel it on the outside of their hip there?
Yes.
Yeah. So we usually have better external rotation than internal rotation. And you might even feel differences from left side to right side. Sit up tall, breathe in, exhale on that counter twist. Now our breath is going to be super important here. If you haven't taken yin yoga, we talk about this all the time. Your exhales control your rest and relaxed state. Your inhales will amp you up. So if you've ever done Wim Hof breathing, you're increasing your inhales, you're focusing on your inhales, you're getting your heart rate up. Long exhales will allow us to get deeper into our stretches. It will tell muscles to let go. So we will be using our breath today. Next, we're gonna go into a lizard position. So, lunge position, you might need to use a mat for your knee. From here, we're gonna take either your back leg spiked, pushing through your back heel, or keeping it down on the ground. Back is a little bit harder. Reach up to the ceiling, inhale. Down, elbow to ankle, exhale. Breathe in as you reach up. Breathe out as you come down. Spiking through your back heel, pushing it towards the wall, or driving your pelvis forward if your knee is down. From here, set your back knee down if it's up. Take your hands on either side of your foot and start to rock back into a hamstring stretch. Lean forward into a hip flexor and rock back. These are all part of our warm-up here, part of our dynamic warm-up to get the hips mobile and loose. One more, rock back. And then switch sides through a downward dog. Downward dog, head on your feet. Get those calves moving a little bit, and then right leg up and through, swing it through. Same thing, try to even out your body. If your back leg was elevated, push through that heel. Inhale, reach high. Your full body twist up to the ceiling, your eyes on the fingertips, and then drop your elbow down to your ankle. Exhale. Inhale, reach. Exhale, drop. So if you struggle with the forward to back movements, what we just did here, this is like one of the best things you can do. We will be taking it laterally, left and right next, and I'll show you the same kind of thing. Finish up, last exhale, elbow down. All right, team, meet me on your knees. You might have to, if you have sensitive knees, you might have to fold your mat once or twice. Take your leg out to the side. Lift the left leg out to the side into a kneeling position. So what are these muscles called? Adductors. They add to the body. Abductors, they take away. So think like aliens abducting, going away. Adding, you're going in towards. So adductors, we're gonna work the adductors here. Sit your hips back into a hip hinge and come up, squeeze. Notice my hinge on the hips. My spine stays still and long. So from here, we're going to start to think about that dimmer switch, okay? So we're going to place, actually not yet, come up to that starting position, watch my foot, your heel is the pivot point. Now I want you to start to push your heel down to the floor. So think about what's happening at the hip right now. You have your femur rotating, all those ligaments that are surrounding that capsule are working hard. Pelvis is tucked. If you had a tail, don't let your tail extend. Let that pelvis stay tucked. Now we're gonna go into that dimmer switch. So hands on the ground. And on this one, we're gonna rock our hips back, keeping our spine long. I want you to start low and then start to crank up your intensity by pushing this foot into the floor. Breathe in as you push harder and harder and harder. At the top of your breath, you're gonna exhale and release and come forward. Rock out of it, rock back, breathe in, press, dimmer switch, high, high, high. Exhale at the top of your inhale and come back out. Two more, inhale, rock back. Push your heel, your ball of your big toe down to the floor. Activate the adductors. Exhale out of it. Last one. Rock back. Inhale, push. Keep the pelvis, the left pelvis down to the floor. And then switch sides. Nice. Maybe take a couple of hip rolls on that. Oh, take your body into a tabletop, give a couple of hip rolls. Notice the difference from your left hip and your right hip. Anything?
Yeah.
So that was a really good opportunity to open up our adductors and getting control of that hip socket. Let's go to the other side now. So right leg out, we're sitting up tall. Hip hinge, we're gonna push our hips back and squeeze your hips forward. Now I want you to think about your butt right here. So think about your butt. When you hip hinge, your glutes, they stretch. See if on the way forward, you can reverse the stretch and squeeze. Hips back and stretch. And squeeze. So if you feel low back pain, usually it's because you won't let your hips stretch and the low back has to take over. So think about creating length in that glute muscle. Think about squeezing and getting shorter in that glute muscle. No activation in the low back. Beautiful. Meet me back at the top, and let's go ahead and use that pivot. Drive your heel down to the floor. Lift your heel. Now you're pulling your heel down and feeling the activation of your hamstring. Back down. You're pushing your heel into the ground, feeling the adductors. Yeah.
Does it matter if we tuck our heel?
It does not matter. No. So go down here. So here, it's whatever makes you most stable on this hip. That's a good question. Yeah. I feel more stable with my toe tucked. It might even stretch the back of your foot a little bit more. Okay, down on the ground, tabletop position. Your leg stays extended. Now remember, we're gonna rock back, breathe in. Dimmer switch. Push your foot down into the floor. Activate those adductors. Bring as many motor units as we can to that adductor, and then exhale out. Try to do it with your breath now. Inhale. Dimmer switch, dimmer switch, dimmer switch. At the top of the inhale is when you're done. Exhale out of it and reset. Inhale. Think about ramping up intensity, ramping up power. At the top of the inhale, you're pushing as hard as you can. And on the exhale, you're letting it all go. At this point, you might be getting a little sweaty. Yeah, that's me. You're getting a little bit of body temperature up. That's a great thing. One more. All right, back to tabletop. Give a couple of hip rolls. See if you can think about the leg bone. Getting a little bit of movement, smooth movement, hips back and through. Now we're gonna go into a child's pose. This is the best position for those of you that struggle with deep squats. Big toes to touch, knees as wide as your mat. Crawl your hands out in front. Now if you look at yourself right now, this is what a deep squat looks like. You are able to get into this position because you're unloaded. So from here, what we're gonna do is I want you to take a breath in and you're gonna drive your knees towards each other into the floor, activating those adductors. Inhale, ramp it up. Exhale, release it. So here we go, we're gonna take our knees, we're gonna drive our knees down into the mats, almost like you're trying to do that Jane Fonda thigh master movement. Did I date myself? No, I think it was Suzanne Summers. Was it Suzanne Summers? My mom had two of them. That's all that I know. I'm like, Mom, what do you need two for? Inhale, push those knees in. Exhale, you can rock forward if you want to on the next exhale. Oh, yeah. Inhale, come back and squeeze. Maybe on the next exhale, you can maybe drop your hips a little closer to the floor. Give it like kind of an upward dog type of feeling. Inhale, push back. Now the progressed version of this, if you want to know the progressed version, it's my least favorite move out of any yoga move. It's called a frogger. Your feet are in line with your knees. Your feet are out in a frog position. You're in a tabletop and you're pushing back. This one is way more aggressive on the inner thighs, but if you can progress to that, that's one thing that you can shoot for. Take your knees wider than your hips. Take your heels to match your knees, just like that, Kathleen, yep. And then you want to push your hips back. Don't let your hips tuck. And you're going to squeeze your inner thighs together. Oh man, the hardest part is coming out of it. Yeah. The body does not want to do it. This is the most open you can get. This is how you practice to get to your side splits. Woo. All right, guys, let's come out of it real quick. We're going to go into a reclining. So you're here. Reclining quad stretch. So you want your feet just outside of your body. This is not comfortable for a lot of people that have knee issues. So if you can't do this, just don't do this. Do it maybe with one leg. One leg. So on this one, now what we're looking to do is your hands can be on your feet and you're gonna slowly lean back. And you're gonna start to push your pelvis forward. Some people are able to do this down in the forearms. Some people are able to do this down in the backs. No. Now this is coming from someone that had the worst knees in the world, and look at where I'm at. I've had surgery on this knee, reconstruction. You have to work your way to it. You have to be able to generate space. So if you're here, you got one leg, you're leaning back and you're pushing your pelvis forward. What pushing that pelvis forward does is it helps to lock this hip flexor into place, and you want to create length. Now, wherever you're at, find a spot that is like a 6, 7, or 8 out of discomfort, 10. If it's too much, one leg. Now I want you guys to think about the dimmer switch. You're gonna lift your hips And I want you to try to see if you can push your feet down into the ground on the inhale. Push and inhale, ramp it up. On the exhale, you can release.
Does that come from the glutes?
When you push your toes down to the floor, this muscle is the one that wants to do it. So if you think about it, your quad, what does your quad do? The quad flexes your muscle, and then it contracts to extend your knee. If I'm taking my knee into the most flexed position possible, my quad is on the most stretched position possible. Mobility is now pushing your feet into the floor and trying to activate those thigh muscles in the most lengthened position. Anybody feeling really sharp pain on that one? You feel pain though?
Yes.
So pain with purpose is what we're looking for. The glutes want to do it, that's going to be on the hip up, you're right. And what happens is when you lock your glutes in place, now your hip flexors aren't allowed to let go. So if your glutes are locked in place, you have this on the deepest stretch, so you're right, you will feel it in the glutes, that's a great point. Okay, if you're doing one side, make sure you get even. Cast, so it could be a lot of things. It could be a tightness, it could be an overcompensation from somewhere. When you're in this position, your calf is going to be in the most lengthened position. So it is stretched a little bit. Yeah. You could try to tuck your toes behind you, but I don't know if that would work. Yeah, that would work. Tuck your toes. Nice, Christina. And then you can inhale, push your feet down into the floor. Fire, fire, fire. And exhale. Remember, the knees, they're the middleman. So if we can give them a little bit of alleviation, it helps a lot with our squats and our lunges. Okay, let's come out of it.
Okay, one more time. If you don't, if I can't, this is far back, right?
Yes.
So you're saying modify with one leg.
So modify with one, or you could put a chair behind me. And if this is as far as I can go,
right.
I put a chair behind me.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
And now I'm here, and I'm pushing my feet into the floor. My thighs are fired up, and then maybe I can extend a little further.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so next. This is the best one for lower back pain, in my opinion, and it doesn't look like it would be it because we're attacking it from a different angle. If you need a mat, you can either double stack your mat or you can use one of those dots. So on this one, we're gonna think about our psoas muscle. Who knows what our psoas muscle is?
I used to get in here, right?
Yes, yeah, and so it's a hip flexor. So it's the biggest hip flexor in the body. It attaches to the lower vertebra of the spine. And then it goes across the knee joint and it attaches to the femur. So a lot of times when we sit, that muscle is in the most shortened position. And then we get up and we do some squats and lunges and we put that muscle on a stretch when it's not ready for it. And that's why we're like, oh, I feel that in my lower back. It's actually just really deep. It's on the sides of your spine. So in order for us to lengthen that, we want to take ourselves into a lunge position. If you look at my tailbone, most people that do this, they want to arch their back. I want you to try to tuck your tail and squeeze your glute. Squeeze the glute of the grounded leg, just like Kathleen was talking about, to isolate the quad, and then gently shift your weight forward. So most people, they go and do it like this. We want to tuck and lean. Once it's in the most lengthened position, take a breath in and reach as high as you can straight up to the ceiling. And at the top of your inhale, you're going to exhale, and you're going to bend over to the side. Oh, there you go. Now your chest wants to fold forward. Your goal is to look at the tile directly above your head and spiral your chest open. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna move with our breath here, okay? So we're gonna come back to set position, tuck your tail, shift your hips forward, find the deepest stretch you can right here. Inhale, hand high. Exhale, side body bend. Keep the chest spiraled open. At the end of that exhale, reset. Tuck tail, hinge forward. Breathe in, reach. Treat it as one rep with every breath. And reset after every breath. Move at your own speed, you don't have to stay with me. Tail tuck, hips forward. Inhale tall. Exhale side wall. Keep the chest spiraled open, feel the stretch of that psoas. One more, tail tucked, hips. Inhale high. At the top of the inhale, everyone's different. Exhale side. Oh, yeah, let's go ahead and switch. Woo! Anybody, like, felt that? Like, does anyone feel productive on that?
Yeah.
So a little bit of people with the back, people with the back stuff. Oh, and you're going to feel it in your stabilizing hip, too. It's a two for one. I love that. Yeah, so people with low back issues, they usually love this one. Okay, with your breath, tuck the tail, lean forward, inhale high. Exhale, side body bend. You can see the tile directly above your head. Keep that chest spiraled open. Once the exhale is all the way out, reset. Breathe in high, lengthen. Exhale, side body bend. Great, a few more. Last one. Oh, yes. Come on down to the ground. Woo. Okay. So, these are all exercises that you can squeeze in while you're waiting for me to demo all the exercises. You could be doing these while you're waiting, right before a warm-up. You could be doing 90-90. During, in between stations. You can do this in between stations. So think about the ones that are most productive for you and throw them in. Remember that during your workouts, you don't want to be passive. So you don't want to just be holding a muscle in a lengthened position while you're working out, because what that does is that now doesn't allow the maximum amount of firing to that muscle when it's in that lengthened position. So think about mobility. So you're here, you're squeezing, you're kind of making it tight and active, and I guarantee you the next set of squats will feel amazing. We're gonna go with a 90-90 variation. These are my favorite hip stretches. I do these in front of the TV every single night. So while I'm watching TV, I'm in this position, fast. So, I actually had a fight with Jamie, like not a fight, but a fight about should we get a couch or not? I didn't want a couch. I wanted to be like a man pad. Because now who joins me on the floor in my yoga space? All right, so we're gonna go 90 position with the knees. 90 position with the knees. It's more important to get the knees into position than where we go on our first effort with our upper body. Once you're in this position, you can use your off hand. Now see if you can get as tall as you can and square your chest up to your front leg. Common errors here is that we're leaning over too much into our upper body. Tall chest, turn torso. Now from here, I want you to just lean forward from your hips. Stay tall. You might be able to go just to here. To here, some people are able to go all the way forward. Now stay active. You should feel that deep stretch on your hip. Cool?
Then when you say stay active, it just doesn't mean you're trying to lengthen the stretch.
Exactly. So if you look at me, watch the difference between this and this. Right? I'm keeping that hip on its deepest stretch. I'm not completely relaxing into it. Now, once your hip is on the deepest stretch, here's where the dimmer switch comes in. You need to activate those hip muscles by pushing the knee and the ankle as hard as you can down into the ground on your inhale. So inhale, start to push, ramp, ramp. You might even feel a cramp. And on the exhale, I want you to come out of it and twist the opposite direction. Keep your knees where they are. Inhale, turn, reset, lean, ramp it up, push, push, push. Exhale, come out of it. Haul. Oh, I don't know about you guys, but I feel this one so much. Inhale, lift the chest, lean into it, start to push your knee and your ankle as hard as you can to the ground. Beautiful. Come out of it. Okay. We're going to do a little flow here. Take your right hand across the body, armpit to the knee. Then take your chest to your heel. Lean into your stretch. The heel is super hard.
Oh yeah?
Super hard. So sit up tall every time. Take your hand across the body. Twist. Sit up tall. Chest to heel. Maybe you go to here. Maybe you go to here. Maybe you go to here. One more time. Rotate. I know. Yep, hand across, arm into the knee, and then come back to your front heel, chest up. Oh yeah, so you can tell where you're a little bit tighter, you can tell where you have a little bit more limitation. Now stay where you are. This one's gonna suck. So sit up nice and tall. I want you to try to lift your back knee and your back heel off the ground. I know. Yeah. Now stay upright. Common error as we go here. Common error, stay upright, use your hand if you need to. Lift. Now the goal is to hold it up for 3 seconds as maximal as you can. Most people feel cramping at this point. Most people feel tightness or pinching at this point. That's your muscles trying to activate in a position that they never do. Think about if you had never done a bicep curl and then you ask it to do a bicep curl the first time, what's it gonna feel like? Another variation here is you can lift your back heel and then you can open up your back knee. For my athletes that get really progressed on this one, what I'll do is I'll place a band around their ankle or around their knee and I'll use resistance as I go pushing down on that band. So there's different ways we can do it. I'm not gonna put the bands out today. Okay, switch sides. Oh man, maybe give a couple windshield wipers on that one. Damn. And so us doing this one time is amazing. It's so good, but it's not gonna make any effects if you don't continue to do this. So take one or two of these exercises today. Every time you watch TV, get on the floor, or before you wake, or right when you wake up, stack it into your day. I guarantee you, small little efforts over time, you'll get there. Let's do the other side now. So we go on chest nice and tall. Notice maybe one side is easier or harder than the other. You usually choose your best side first. That's just how our body works. Okay, inhale tall, exhale, lean into that stretch. We're gonna just do that front knee for a second. Press your knee and your ankle down into the floor. There should be effort here from 3 to 4 to 5, all the way up to 10. Exhale to come out of it, keep the knees where they are, and counter twist. Square yourself up on the breath in, lean, and drive. And then come out of it on the exhale. Two more on this side before we go into that flow. And you'll notice that both sides could be different. You'll notice that your body wants to speed through where it's a little bit uncomfortable. So just be aware of that and try to spend a little bit more time where the body is trying to speed up. Once you feel even with that other side, go ahead and let's take your hand across the body, armpit towards the knee, and then lift the chest and see if you can go towards your heel. Move with your breath. Anytime you find a really sticky spot, a spot where you're like, whoa, this is tight, take a breath in and try to exhale through it. Remember, the exhale tells the body to let go, to lengthen, to release. Okay, last time to the heel. And then if you're ready for it, let's see if we can get that back leg. You ready? I don't even know if I can do it on this side. Ah! If both knee and ankle are not accessible, just try the ankle.
With it, my body wants to move forward.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
And it cramps.
And it cramps, and it's gonna cramp. And all that is a muscle that is not used to firing.
Right, exactly.
Mine is right here in my QL, my glute med area. That's where I feel the
right
cramp.
Here.
You're right in the TFL. Yeah. So you have a right attached to your IT band, which is a big bundle of it's like a mixture between a tendon and a ligament. It's a harder tissue and it has a lot of sensory neurons, so it's very tender and sensitive. But above is a small muscle called the TFL. It's right where your pocket would be, and that muscle sometimes needs to be stretched or rolled almost. You can try to open up your knee. Oh. So really all you're trying to do is get that leg bone to be able to move in all ranges of motion. Okay, go ahead and let the legs be free. So we're gonna finish it up here. We went dynamic stretching, we went mobility, activating, and now we're gonna do some strength exercises in order to reinforce where your hips are now. Your hips have more movement than they're used to. In order for them to continue to stay with that range of motion, we need to be able to strengthen, to reinforce the position. So, what we're gonna do is a single leg hip thrust. We're gonna go up into a bridge by pushing our lower back down to the floor. Common error when you do a hip bridge is letting your entire spine arch. We wanna tuck the tail underneath of us, our pelvis is tilted, and now we're just gonna bring our hips up and squeeze. From this position, we'll take it into a single leg. So tuck the low back down to the ground, tuck the tail, Lift your hips off the floor with your glute muscles. Everything stays the same. I just want you to lengthen at the knee. Shoot that leg straight forward. So your knees should be in alignment. Both knees should be in the same position. Now from here, drive through your grounded floor on the inhale, grounded heel on the inhale. Squeeze your glutes and keep those hips high on the exhale. Stability, strength. You're using a muscle. It should be very, very fatiguing. Essentially, when I have clients, I just do this one until they drop. So some last longer than others, but they all eventually drop. Once you drop, rest for a second, and then reset your double A hip ridge, reset your pelvis, reset your low back down to the ground, lift your hips, and do the other leg.
Where should our feet be?
Feet hip width apart, toes pointed straight forward. Great question.
And our arms?
Arms, I like palms down on the ground to help support me.
It's weird because if I do these in class, I'll get really squeezed up, but I think it's
wobbling.
Yep. So Kathleen says she usually feels her hips seize up when she just does it in the class, and most of the time that's because we didn't properly prime the muscle or the joint. So a lot of times your body's going to default to the strongest muscle, and it's just going to keep using the strongest muscle until it doesn't need to anymore. So I can do this movement by using my butt only. I can do this movement by having my hamstrings and my lower back assist. I can do this movement with only my lower back. But your body's gonna default to what it's strongest at. So your goal is to try to connect to the movements in the proper way, and then in class, just really focus on staying present on that feeling and activating that muscle. Usually if you can't feel the muscle that I'm talking about in class, you're compensating with a different muscle. So the only goal is to regress the weight, regress the variation, try to find that sensation, and then slowly amp it up. It's a lot. I've been doing this for 20 years, and I still, every single day that I work out, I still am trying to make these little adjustments. We are so disconnected with our body nowadays, it's just, it's hard.
Yeah,
the pelvis tuck is the biggest thing, because what that does is that doesn't allow that lower back to take the arch. Okay, guys, but next, we're going to go into a seated position. We got two more moves, and then we'll retest. So this one sucks. I've been saying that with all of them. So a lot of us that have tight hamstrings, on this one it's going to be really challenging. We want to shoot our legs straight out in front of us. We're going to pull our toes to our nose. The goal is to have our upper body directly straight up and down. A lot of people can do that, so if you need to, put your hands behind you and push your chest forward. Right now your hamstrings are on the deepest stretch and your quads are in a shortened position. I want you to be careful, you're going to cramp, almost everyone. Take your hip and I want you to lift your heel as high as you can off the ground. Lean forward. Hold it there, as high as you can. Toe to shin, hold, hold, hold. 3, 2, set it down, reset, yeah, cramp, yeah. I still cramp and I do this every day. Come up and hold, other leg. Lean forward, your body wants to get away from it. You don't want to get away from it, you want to lean into it. 3, 2, reset. So what this one is really good at doing is getting you to fire your thigh muscles. If you have pain in your hip flexors, tight hips up front when you squat or lunge, this is the movement right here that's gonna help alleviate, especially if you have knee pain when you do that. Let's do it one more time. Toes up, chest up, lean forward, lift. Sometimes I'll take a yoga block and I'll go up and over that yoga block. I know. Breathe. Chest is tall. Hamstrings are flying up. I warned you. All right, release it.
So, Dave, you're just saying that doing this will take that particular thing away?
What you're doing is you're strengthening a muscle that's weak, and it's usually weak. Yeah, so the hip flexors here, a lot of times when you have pain in your knees and it won't go away when you stretch it, if you stretch a muscle constantly, this is most common in the neck. If you're always like stretching your neck, the muscle's not tight. The muscle's weak and needs to be strengthened. So if you're stretching and there's no improvement in how you feel, stop stretching, start strengthening. So there's different ways to do that. So this would be the way to strengthen the hip flexors. It's the opposite of this move here, which is lengthening the hip flexors. So we're attacking it in two different ways. Great question. Last one is going to be the tabletop hip cars. This one is the hardest one for me. I just have a lot of hard time controlling the hip bone. So tabletop, we're going to go super slow, and I want you to think about the pelvis. Your pelvis is stuck. It doesn't move. So from here, like a dog peeing on a fire hydrant, take your right knee out to the right and hold it as far as it can, but don't go so far that your pelvis moves. For me, it's like a 3-inch move. It's not very far. Now, I want you to think about a pencil on the end of your knee and draw the biggest, slowest circle up and around and back to the starting position. Good. So if I had a bowl of water on your back, it would not spill. Super slow. Can you slow it down uncomfortably? Nice. So first movement is going to be out like a fire hydrant. Feel the squeeze of your glute before you move. Up and around. Every single muscle of that hip working. Your body wants to shift over onto your left knee. See if you can keep it square. Wide fingers gripping through the ground for that base of support. Try to reverse your circle now. Now from here, do a donkey kickback, but don't let your pelvis tuck. Keep your pelvis tucked just like that hip bridge. Donkey kickback, big circle up and around. Back to the start. CARS stands for controlled articular rotations. When you hear the word articular, you're thinking your bones, your joints. Your knee stays at 90 degrees. All right, when you're done with your last circle, maybe do a couple of hip rolls and let's make sure we even out the other side. Woo, I know. All right, team, ready? Last leg, open up. Oh man, I'm a little limited on this side compared to my other. Up and over, return back to knee under the hips. Out. There you go. Up and around. That's not good. That's pretty tight. So usually you start with your stronger side. Your body automatically goes to your stronger side. So my challenge to you is when we have a single side move in the room and you default to going to one side, stop for a second and just switch. Switch to the other side and start with your weaker side. Go ahead and rest. Good job, guys. All right, let's stand up real quick. Give a couple of maybe hip rolls to get it out. We're gonna retest now. We're gonna retest to see what our squats feel like. We're gonna retest to see what if there's any better depth, any better range of motion. So let's do your 5 squats, remembering what all the way we did back at the beginning. Feel your butt stretch on the way down. Feel your butt squeeze and lift you up on the way up. Chest stays tall. Maybe you're able to connect to the muscles a little bit better. Maybe you're able to keep the chest up a little bit higher. Maybe there's no improvement and it's gonna take a few more rounds. Now let's go into your deep squat. Deep squat. Do you feel any different? Are you in a different position? Different. It's totally fine if you're not. Feels a little more comfortable. You can be here a little longer. Some of you look like you're getting a little lower. Great.
A little more fluid.
So, I'm going to be sending you a video and I have extra credit mobility training. There's exercises that you can follow along to. So there's a YouTube video, there's Instagram videos, there's exercises here for hip impingement, 5-minute morning mobility, pre-squat warm-up, snapping hip, if you ever have that snapping hip.
Yeah.
So make sure you check your email. If you do not get this email, let me know. This is going to be for you guys to just do at home, so there's going to be homework in there. If you guys have any other questions, let me know, but that's it. That's all I got for you.